Remix 2.1.0 just dropped, and one of the things I'm most excited about is the view transition API. This isn't something that Remix invented. In fact, Google actually created it, but Remix has now added first-class support to be able to use it. Bear in mind, this support is experimental. We are still playing around with the APIs and trying to figure out what we like and what we don't like. So please do give us feedback as you use this. And another word of caution is this is actually not supported across most major browsers. It is in Google and in all Chromium type browsers like Edge, but it is not in Firefox or Safari. So use at your own risk and just know that the features that you're getting will not necessarily show up for those other browsers. However, that's probably okay because there's a pretty good backwards compatibility story and we'll explore that a little bit. So if you look at the Remix v2.1.0 release notes, you'll see a little blurb about the view transitions, and you also see this link to Matt Brophy's work where he created a little demo of the view transitions. We do want to give a shout out to Astro Records, which was created by Astro, the Astro framework. They've already supported view transitions. So they had this really nice demo showing off how to do view transitions, what they can look like. And so this is just a fork of that written in React Router. So not even Remix. That's one of the nice things here is since Remix is built on React Router, if you have a React Router app, you can already use this kind of view transition stuff and play with this unstable API. You don't have to be in Remix specifically. So if we look at the live demo, we can see that you've got all these little images of different records. And if you open it, you get this nice little transition and then the vinyl pops out. We can go back and it kind of fades away, open a new one, same kind of thing. If we hit play, it'll start spinning. So very cool. So how does this work? The API is actually pretty simple. You just pass this unstable view transition flag to something like a link component, and that kind of kicks everything off. The actual API itself, you can look on MDN and you can see the view transition API and how it works. There's actually a little bit of JavaScript you have to do to set it up. It's very general so that anyone can kind of use it. And what we're trying to do at Remix is we're trying to make declarative APIs on top of that. That's very much the React way. And that's kind of how we believe that your API should work, is they should feel very declarative for the most part. So if you'd like, and I would definitely recommend it, read through the MDN doc. It shouldn't take more than maybe 30 minutes just to read through and understand at a high level how this is working and how JavaScript and CSS and all these different pieces play together to make this work. And if you really want to dive in deeper, there's the smooth and simple transitions with the view transition API on the developer.chrome.com docs. And this is super helpful, a lot more in-depth explanations about how to debug the view transition animations and all that good stuff. So those are going to be two really helpful resources beyond just the Remix docs themselves. So that's enough of the high level, what is this? Let's now dive into some code and see how we can implement the view transition API in a Remix app. I'm gonna open up a new incognito window. And the reason I'm doing that is just because sometimes the animations get cached in weird ways. So I just wanna make sure we're starting from a fresh standpoint. I'll go to localhost3000/blog. There's nothing actually going on yet. I haven't started the dev server because the first thing I need to do is I need to do npx upgrade remix. And we'll just do latest to make sure that we get the latest. This should update us to 2.1.0. Great, now I'm going to run npm run dev to get the dev server running, and I'm gonna switch over here, give this a refresh, and now it should be loading our blog, perfect. Now if we open any of these specific blogs, you can just see that it's a normal transition, not really a transition at all, it just replaces the content with the new content, which is perfectly fine. Honestly, it's not the worst experience in the world, but sometimes you maybe want to add a little bit of flash, a little bit of a nice kind of transition to draw one's eye to some main content or something like that. So how can we do this? First, we need to open up the appropriate file. So we got the blog.tsx, and let me close this. So here we can have our link. This is what actually links to all of the different blogs in this list. This one is the main header. So if I comment that out, you can see that this big one goes away. So that's like not the header, but the featured blog. So that's easy. And so if we type unstable view transition, if we just pass that into the link component, what this does is automatically this is going to say, okay, whenever you hit this link, I'm going to start the view transition process automatically. And the default for this is going to be a crossfade between the two pages. So giving this a refresh to make sure that it took, we're going to click it. And you can see there was that nice little transition. I'll click another one and going back, you see that's just this crossfade. So this is a good time to talk about what exactly is the view transition API doing. Well, the idea is that it's first taking basically a snapshot of the previous page of just whatever was on it. And then it renders the new page. And then it figures out some way to kind of tween between the two, to go between the two. And like I said, the default is a crossfade. So if we open up our inspector, another thing that we can do is we can go to the elements tab. And if we have this animations tab open on the bottom part here, this is in Chrome again, if we put a pause, we can go ahead and start a transition and see these little view transition pseudo elements. So we can see there's a colon colon view transition, colon colon view transition group. Root will always be there. Just if you don't supply anything else, you always have a root. Then you have an image pair, and the image pair holds the old and the new. So pretty straightforward for the most part. And again, if you just want to crossfade, you don't have to do anything else. This is done. You can commit and push this and ship it and you're good. But we want to do a little bit more than that. One thing we could do is if we're going in between these different pages, let me start playing this again. Maybe we want the little image here to kind of turn into the next image. So we can see it's really big right here and it's got Matt Brophy and future proofing your remix app, all that text and everything. That'd be nice if we had a transition, an animation that brought that up there and kind of made it big and added that text and everything. So let's see if we can figure out how to do that. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to try and add a class name to this image. So we'll say style equals view transition name. And unfortunately, this is not going to be happy because React types just don't have the view transition name. But I can assure you, if we go back to MDN, view transition API, you can see view transition name is something that you can give to a specific element. And this will allow you to have a lot more control over what the view transition API is doing. So we can give it any name that we want. The only name that we can't give it is none, because that explicitly opts it out of the transition. So view transition name, that is what we're looking for. And it is camel cased here just because we're using the style prop from React. So view transition name, let's give this the name of blog image. That should be fine. This can be named whatever we want. And we can see here that once we reload this and try and do the animation, this is actually going to be a bit of a problem. So we'll get this unexpected duplicate view transition name of blog image. And the transition actually didn't even happen because we had those duplicates. So every element that you want to give a specific view transition name to, it must be a unique name. Your first thought might be to add like a special key or an ID to each of these blog items, but that would actually be kind of a problem because you would be animating every single one of them. And we really only want to animate the one that you click. So this is where Remix gives us a really nice API. If we switch from a link to a nav link, this will get a lot easier. So a nav link, the docs of it are actually pretty helpful. It just says a special kind of a link that knows whether it is active. So it basically knows a little bit more about its state than the average link. And we can turn this into a render props. We're gonna need a fragment here. We'll throw all of this inside of that. And for now, this should just look the way it did before and it should work the way it did before. So we'll test that. Yep, it's still broken because we haven't fixed things yet. And what we can do is we can say, we can pull off is active, is pending, is transitioning. We can pull off these little states because the nav link knows exactly what's going on when it's clicked. So we can say if transitioning, we want to add this view transition name with blog image. Otherwise, we'll just have it as undefined. That's fine. The style can be undefined. It just won't add any styles. So now we're not going to have the same problem that we had before. We're just going to have one element transition and it's going to know exactly which element it should because that name will be unique. Now we can go back and test to make sure that this worked correctly. So nothing's really changed too much that we have the transition back. But the thing is, if you want to transition a specific element, you need to give it that name, but you also need to give the new version of that element, whatever it's transitioning into, a name as well. So back in our code, we're going to open up blog.slug. or $slug.tsx. So that is this page specifically. And so here we want to take this image and we're going to give it the same thing. We're going to give it style. And I should actually look at what we called that. There we go, blog image. It's very important that those are named the same thing. Maybe you want to check that out as a const somewhere else and to share those two. That's kind of up to you how you want to architect that. So now that this image has the view transition name of blog image and our other image has the view transition name of blog image, when we transition between the two, when we go between the two different pages, it should just work. It should be able to animate things correctly. So we're going to go back to the blog and we're going to click one of these and we'll see that it kind of did this sort of animation. I'll go back and we can see what that looks like. It's not perfect, but this is definitely closer. So we're getting there. So the first thing is, when we're transitioning, and let me actually slow this down because it's a lot easier to see. You can see that the text is all kind of already in the background, which I really don't like, and it kind of stays there. I want the text to come along with it and maybe fade in with it. And so what I can do is I can try and figure out, okay, well, here's this image. It has this div and then this container div with the post title, et cetera, et cetera. So I think what I want is I actually want the view transition name on the larger div. So the nice thing is you don't actually have to put the view transition name on like elements. So it doesn't have to go from an image to image exactly. It can go from just one element to a new element, because what it's doing is it's taking that snapshot from the previous thing and then transitioning into the snapshot of the new version. So it doesn't really care what your elements are from what I know. So let's try this one more time. I'm gonna give this a refresh and let's see if I click this, that looks a lot better. So that is definitely significantly better. There is still one little thing that's wrong. If you look at the bottom of these, there's like this extra little area that I don't love, that's just not expanding in a weird way. But if we take a step back and think about this, it's pretty cool that this even is doing this already, that it's even doing this transition of size and of position, everything. And that's just by default, when we specify a specific element to transition, not just the whole page, there's some stuff out of the box that the view transition API is going to automatically figure out, like, oh, you probably do want to do some kind of translation in space. So that's really nice. We just need to give it a little bit more of a hint that, hey, we also would like to transition that height. We want that to kind of expand out a little bit too. So I'm going to open up a CSS file, and here we're going to do view transition. We'll get the new, and it just needs to be the same name. We keep grabbing that blog image. So here we have the new one. And this is how you essentially you grab that pseudo element and you can give it specific attributes and you can change things about the animation. And then we'll do view transition old with the same blog image. And here what we're going to say is we're going to say height is 100%. And so that allows it to know that that's kind of the attribute that it should be transitioning as well, height to 100% of its container. So let's see if that fixed things. I'm going to click on one of these blog posts. And that's looking pretty good. Let's go back and I'll go up to 25% to make this a little bit more clear. And transitioning between the two. We don't have that one set up, so we'll do that in a second. But transitioning between the two, there's not as much of an awkward space in the middle. Let me slow that down just a little bit again. Yeah, looking pretty good. So that's exactly what we're wanting. So this is great. Let's just add it to this main blog. And I think that will help everything work out a lot nicer. So going up here, we just need to do the same thing, nav link, and we're gonna wrap it again in render props and also in a fragment. So here, and then with the render props, we need to add a little function and then we can pull off is transitioning. And then with is transitioning, we're just gonna copy and paste the same thing we had down here, style, and we'll add it to this thing. Cool. So now let's just make sure this one works. Okay, it didn't work. So going back, what is the problem? So we need to actually add this unstable view transition because we need to tell Remix and React Router to go ahead and start the view transition process. So if we add that on, give this a refresh, and if we click the main blog button, we now have a little transition between the two. We could keep tweaking this to make sure it looks exactly how we want it to, but I think this is all right, especially if we go back to 100% of speed, this should look pretty good. Cool, I'm pretty happy with that, at least for now. All right, there's one more thing we need to talk about, and that is responsibility with this API. So this is a cool API. It's got a lot of, you know, bells and whistles and flashy stuff you can do, but we do want to be really cognizant of when we're implementing something new and something fun and flashy, especially with animation. We just don't want to overdo it. We don't want to drive our users nuts with all our things spinning and moving around. If you remember the marquee HTML element, they actually deprecated this because, I mean, several reasons, but it was pretty obnoxious. Here we go. You can see it's just makes stuff slide around and whatnot. So we want to be really conscientious when we are doing animation stuff that we're not going to drive our users nuts. And then especially if a user has something like prefers reduced motion enabled, that's an accessibility issue where they're saying, hey, I can maybe get motion sick or vertigo or whatever it may be from a lot of motion, and we want to respect that. So that's the final thing we're going to look at. We're going to look at how can we leverage prefers reduced motion to basically disable this. You could dampen it, you could lessen it, you could do something else, but I'm just going to essentially get rid of this whole view transition if the user has prefers reduced motion enabled. So jumping back into the code, I'm going to add a media query with prefers reduced motion. Then if that's true, we'll take the view transition old for root, so just everything basically, and view transition new root, that one. And here we're just gonna say animation None. We do need to turn on prefers reduce motion. So in Mac, I can go to accessibility and then I go to display and hit reduce motion. Now, if I click any of these, we should see less motion. There is still some motion, so I'm going to slow this down and see if anything actually is changing. So we can see there's still the animation happening with the actual picture itself, but the crossfade is no longer happening, which is good. So we've reduced most of the motion, but because we opted in to animating the image, we need to explicitly kind of undo that. So here, instead of adding the style, we're going to dynamically add a class name. And the reason we're going to do that is because we'll just have a little bit more control in our CSS to use the media queries, which is what we want. So I'm going to wrap this and it's been called CLSX. And that's just a little util that allows me to dynamically add class names very easily. So I can say that if is transitioning is true, well, if it's undefined, if it's false, it'll be undefined. But if it's true, we're going to give a name of, we'll say, view transition blog image. So just a really ridiculously long name. And we're going to want that same thing down below. So we can delete all of this. And I'll just actually copy all of this part. And down below here, we can have CLSX again. And add that exact same stuff and delete all of the style that we had before. So this view transition blog image, what we need to do is we need to go back into our CSS and we need to add here, we're going to say view transition name and that name will be blog image. So it's the exact same one we had before. So here we have blog image and just to keep things consistent, we will go ahead and add it here as well. Now this time we don't need to use CLSX because we don't have multiple elements on the page that are all going to have this name. So we don't have that conflict, which is good. So now if they have prefers reduced motion on, we're going to turn off this view transition name. Also, this shouldn't be in quotes. That's going to be a problem later if we had that there. So view transition name, and then we'll just say that that name will be none if prefers reduced motion is on. And of course, this needs to be for the actual view transition blog image class. So that should solve everything for us. So going back to our site, give this a refresh. Okay, cool, with prefers reduce motion on, there's no animations, which is great, but if I turn it back off, we should get our animations again. Cool, so now we've honored the settings that the user has, and we give a nice little animation for the users that are okay with animations, and for those who aren't, we've just removed the animation. We could reduce it, we could do whatever we want. We have the full power of the browser at our hands. So I hope this gets you really excited about the Vue Transition API, and I hope that you get an opportunity to build some really cool stuff, and please show us how it works. And of course, as I've said, this is unstable right now, this API. It could change, and it could change if you give us feedback to help make it even better. Feel free to reach out to us on Discord if you have any other thoughts, or you can open up a discussion on GitHub, or even open up an issue if you find a bug with our implementation.